what I know of Dennis Brutus, first and foremost, of course, is his wonderful poetry, because I'm a literature person myself and as a writer. But incidentally, the first time I met Dennis Brutus was in Athens, Ohio, here at Ohio University, around, I think it was 1982 or 1983, when we as Ohio University students, African students, that is, invited him. At the time, he was teaching at Northwest University in Illinois. He was a professor there. So we invited him over to give us a reading and a lecture and so on, because he was highly involved in a movement that was fighting for disinvestment and also for the cultural and sports boycott of South Africa. He started a movement called Sun Rock in 1962, before he left South Africa. Sun Rock stands for South African Non-Racial Olympic Committee. Its objective was to put pressure on the nations of the world and on international sports organizations to banish South Africa from the membership. Why? Because South Africa was practicing apartheid, which was racial segregation and racial oppression. Black people, for instance, were not allowed in certain sporting activities, or when they were allowed, they would only have their segregated sporting activities without any facilities provided for them at all. And of course, in many of these sports, black people could not represent the country. In the Olympics, for instance, would only have white people, and in other sporting bodies. So Sun Rock's objective, although of course it focused, as the name says, in the Olympics, but generally it fought for the boycott of in all sports. In FIFA, for instance, when South Africa was finally kicked out of FIFA, which is the international soccer body, it was precisely because of organizations such as Sun Rock. In fact, not just because of such, but mainly because of Sun Rock, and mainly, more than anybody else, because of the work that Dennis Brutus did. So when then he went to exile from South Africa in 1966, he took Sun Rock with him, first to London, where he was in exile there for some time, and it continued to be very active. And then in 1970, he moved to the United States. That's when then he was at Northwestern, and then later in Pittsburgh, and so on and so forth, taking Sun Rock, of course, and its activities with him. So when we invited him here in 81, 82, it was part and parcel of that movement that was fighting for the boycott of South Africa, and also for disinvestment. Because during those years, a number of American universities had heavy investments in companies that were operating in South Africa. And of course, people like Dennis Brutus were putting pressure on these universities and on the companies themselves to withdraw from South Africa because of racial segregation in South Africa, because of apartheid and so on. So you see, his work was very crucial in the changes that later happened. Now, of course, the legacy of apartheid, you continue to see it today in international sporting activities, except for soccer, in other sporting activities, in the Olympics and so on, is still mostly white South Africans who represent the country. The reason, of course, is that black sports, you know, in other sporting activities, they were never developed. They were never afforded the opportunity, you know, to compete internationally and so on. They never had those facilities. You see that? So you see the legacy that of the political system continues to this day. Those are the things that Dennis Brutus was fighting against. Those are the things that then he continued to fight against even after apartheid. Because you see, unlike many of his comrades, who then, of course, after apartheid, then they became big shots in the government and so on, and then began to enjoy the fruits of liberation by hook or by crook, he continued to stay outside the system and to fight against his former comrades. You see, he had served with them in jail. He was in Robben Island with them for many years. You know, people like Mandela and others and so on. He served with them. He fought against them. Even up to the very year that he died, he was involved in a number of activities. You know, climate change, for instance, you know, issues of environment, issues of reparations against the, you know, I mean, for the victims of apartheid and so on. So those were still the issues that that concerned him a lot. But what hurt him most, of course, was that the equality that he fought for in sports, he still could not see it. That is why when in the year 2007, he was now being awarded membership to the South African Sports Hall of Fame, he turned it down. He rejected that. He turned it down precisely because he felt that sports in South Africa had not adequately dealt with that legacy of racist history. He felt that we still needed to have some kind of a truth and reconciliation commission that is going to look at sports, how sports damaged South Africa, and how it continues, you know, not to deal with the issues, not to address these issues adequately. So, right up to his death, he continued to be a fighter. In Athens here, of course, he was here for about a week or so. He addressed a number of meetings here and so on. And demonstrations, because you see, he believed very much in the power of mass action. You see, he organized a demonstration right here, you know, because he always looked for a cause, you know. He was a rebel, you know, true. That is how some of us, of course, joined that movement. Because we fought generally for disinvestment, for the cultural boycott, or sports boycott of South Africa. And he was our leader in that regard.